Hallelujah. Because God is set to bless our lives. God is set to transform our lives. God is set to do something supernatural in our lives. In the name of the Lord Jesus. And you see, before I share the word, I have a testimony to share. You see, there is nothing impossible for God to do. Somebody say with me, amen.
Amen.
Some weeks ago, about six weeks ago, when this COVID just started, I was very strong. A lady called me and said, Pastor, my younger sister in Owerri, in Imo State, has just been diagnosed of COVID. She can't breathe. She's on oxygen. She's about to die. Everybody had given up. Pastor, can God do something? I said, God can do more than something. Give me the number, let me call. He said, she can't even talk. I said, but she can hear. Let the nurse that is taking care of her in the hospital just put the phone on her ears and let's pray. And we prayed a simple prayer. And the God who is awesome in all his ways, who is mighty in all his heart, in less than the 14 days she was to spend in isolation, she got back on her feet. She was discharged and she's well. 3 days ago, someone called me here in Abuja, a medical doctor, a top staff of the National Assembly, and she said, my uncle has just been taken to isolation center in Gwagalada Hospital, diagnosed with COVID. The man is having some, you know, sickness already before, and now with this COVID, there is no hope. I said, there is hope in Jesus.
Amen.
And we prayed together. And yesterday, I received a message from her on my WhatsApp. And he said, Pastor, your God is great.
Hallelujah.
He said, my uncle is doing very well.
Amen.
As soon as you finish praying, and I got to the hospital, what I saw amazed me.
Hallelujah.
He said, Pastor, check your alert. And she sent me 20,000 naira seed. She said, I'm just thanking God with this. Hear me. God can do anything. And God can do everything. There is nothing in this whole world that is beyond the power of our God to solve. And this morning, I don't know what you came with. I don't know the burden in your heart. I don't know the agony in your heart. I don't know the trauma in your heart. This morning, God will visit you.
Amen.
I say the Lord will visit you.
Amen.
The Lord will do something supernatural in your life.
Amen.
And your life will never be the same again.
Amen.
Lift your two hands to God. Say with me, Father,
I receive
your divine thoughts, your supernatural thoughts in the name of Jesus. Go ahead and pray. Let the hand of the Lord touch you now. Let the grace of the Lord touch you now. Let the power of the Lord touch you now. Let the anointing of the Lord touch you now. Oh Lord, we thank you for your grace, for your glory, for your power, for your mercy. Thank you for touching your people this morning with your healing balm, with your power, with your fire, with your grace in the name of Jesus. Whatever is in your life, whatever is in your body that is not of God, I command it right now. Disappear in the name of Jesus. Disappear in the name of Jesus. Every migraine disappear. High blood pressure disappear. Diabetics disappear. Malaria disappear. Cancer disappear. In the name of Jesus. Whatever that has a name that is in your body, I confront it with the superior name of Jesus. And I cast it out in the name of Jesus. Receive your healing now. Receive your miracle now. Receive your healing now. Receive your miracle now. And you will testify. And the name of the Lord shall be glorified. Thank you, Father. Lord, speak your word into our lives this morning. And let the testimonies of your people be unending to the glory and praise of your name. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Matthew chapter 14. I'm reading very quickly from verse 22. And I'm reading to verse 34. Immediately, Jesus made his disciples get into the boat and to go before him to the other side, while he sent the multitudes away. And when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up into the mountain by himself to pray. And when evening came, he was there alone. But the boat was now in the middle of the sea, tossed by the waves, for the wind was contrary to them. And then in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went to them walking on the sea. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled. And they said, "It is a ghost." And they cried out for fear. But immediately, Jesus spoke to them, saying, "Be of good cheer. It is me. Be not afraid." And Peter answered him and said, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." And so he said, "Come." And when Peter had come down out of the boat, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. But when he saw the wind was boisterous, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, he cried out, saying, "Lord, save me." And immediately Jesus stretched out his hand and caught him and said to him, "O ye of little faith, why did you doubt?" And when they got into the boat, the wind ceased. Then those who were in the boat came and worshipped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." And when they had crossed over, they came to the land of Gennesaret. May the Lord bless the reading of his words in Jesus' name.
Amen.
This morning I'm speaking on the topic, "It is time to walk on the water."
Hallelujah.
Can you please say it with me? Say, "It is time."
It is time.
You are not saying it with boldness. Can you say it louder? Say, "It is time to walk on the water." Look at your neighbor. Say, "Neighbor, it is my time to walk on the water." Hey, say it one more time. Say, "It is my time to walk on the water." Glory to God forever. Just follow me. "Pastor, what do you mean that I should walk on the water?" You will soon understand it now. Everything God has done in the past is to prepare us for the future. Every work of God, as we read in the Bible, or as we see it happen in our contemporary days, are not just historical. No. They are PowerPoints. They are prophetically pointing us to the future. Everything that God has ever done in the past are not just history. They are prophecies of what is to come and of what is possible. If you ever read or heard that God gave a child to Anna when it looks impossible, it is because God is able to do it again today. If you ever heard or read that God visited Sarah as he has said and did unto Sarah as he has spoken, it simply points to the fact that whatever God says to you, He is going to bring it to pass. Everything that God has ever done in the past are prophetic, pointing us to the future. And before we go to this place we just read, the Bible tells us that Jesus had just fed 5,000 men with the meal of a little child. Men, excluding the women and children. And that is to prepare these disciples to believe in the impossible. Jesus didn't just feed those 5,000, but Jesus was actually teaching his disciples, who will carry on with his work of redemption, that there is nothing that is impossible with God. And if you have read that same passage of scripture, it's a pointer to you that the little you have can accomplish anything for you. It's a pointer that when God is involved in your business, you will have more than enough. Hallelujah. And after this has happened, Jesus now said to them, get into the to the other side. Get into the ship and go over to the other side. And there are five things quickly I want to say concerning that. Number one, Jesus will not send you to where he himself will not go. When you read that place, the Bible says he said to them, go over to the other side before me. Jesus said to them, go before me to the other side. So Jesus didn't send them to a place that he himself will not go. Jesus is not like man that will tell you to fast but will be feasting. Jesus is not like man that will tell you don't steal, but himself is corrupt. Jesus is not like man that will tell you don't commit adultery, but he's sleeping with everything he gets. Jesus will do as he says and say as he does. Hallelujah. He said, go ahead of me to the other side. So wherever you are going in this life, I want you to be assured that Jesus is going with you. Amen. I can hear your amen.
Amen.
He said, lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the earth. Go ye therefore and preach the gospel to every creature, teaching them to observe everything that I have taught you, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And lo, I am with you always. And they went everywhere preaching the gospel, the Lord walking with them and confirming the word with signs following. How God anointed Jesus Christ of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good, healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. Jesus won't send you out and not go with you. As a matter of fact, in Isaiah 45, he said, thus saith the Lord to his anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I have holding. He said, I will go before you. I will go before you. And I will make the crooked places straight. I will remove the gate of brass. I will cut asunder the bars of iron. Hallelujah.
Amen.
God will not send you to where he himself will not go. Number two, there is an other side to everything in this life. There is another side. There is the other side. If you are poor, that is not the only side. There is another side of prosperity. If you are sick, that is not the only side. There is another side of healing and health. Hallelujah.
Amen.
If you are barren, that is not the only side. there is another side of fruitfulness and productivity. Hallelujah. If you are empty, that is not the only side. There is another side of plenty and abundance and overflow. For everything in this life, there is another side. And as you are seated here this morning, if you will believe the word of the Lord, or as you are watching online right now, God is about to take you to the other side. I say the Lord is about to take you to the other side. I said the Lord is taking you right now to the other side. Can you name the other side you want the Lord to take you to? Which other side do you desire? You are a tenant. There is another side of being a landlord and being a host estate owner. You are jobless. There is another side of being an employer of labor. You are poor. There is another side of prosperity. You don't know the Lord. There is another side of the knowledge of God. Which other side do you desire this morning? As you are mentioning it to the Lord, grace and power for accomplishment is being released upon you in the name of Jesus. I declare a supernatural shift for you. Amen. To the other side as you have desired. Amen. To the other side as you have imagined. Amen. To the other side as you have prayed. Amen. In the name of Jesus. Amen. There is another side. There is another side. Hallelujah. Amen. Beloved, there is another side. Amen. And listen, above all, there is another side to this life. There is the mortal life. There is another side, the immortal life. There is another side to this Adamic life. There is another life of the Christ life, of the eternal life, of the supernatural life. Hallelujah. And I pray this morning that God will move you to that other side. Amen. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Number three. To get to the other side, there is always a means, a carriage, a vehicle, a channel by which God moves men to their other side in life. Concerning these disciples of Jesus, he said to them, I want you to go to the other side. Get into the booth. Get into the ship. Hey, that ship can be a friendship. That ship can be a fellowship. That ship can be a stewardship. There is a ship that heaven has prepared as a vehicle, as a channel to move men to their other side in life. And when you maximize the opportunity of the ship God makes available for you, there is a guarantee that you will get to your other side. Amen. I said there is a guarantee that you will get to your other side. Amen. There was a friendship of Jonathan with David that would deliver David from the death of his father. Hallelujah. Amen. There was a stewardship of a soul to run an errand for his father by which he will connect with the apostleship of a Samuel that will move him from being an ordinary Benjamite to becoming the first king of Israel. There is a ship heaven has prepared for you. There is a ship heaven has prepared for you. This church is a fellowship. It's a ship. What God is doing here is not the same as he's doing there. Yes, it's not the same as he's doing somewhere. Yes, and when you maximize the opportunity of this fellowship, it can do anything in your life. Hallelujah. It can transform anything in your life. So maximize the opportunity of every ship, of every fellowship, of every stewardship, of every apostleship, of every friendship that the Lord brings your way. There is a ship to carry us in life to the other side that we desire. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Number four. That you are going as commanded by the Lord and according to the word of God. That you are in a ship prepared by the Lord, appointed by the Lord, and you are going to the other side as directed by the Lord. We not exclude you from the waves, from the storm, from the fear and the challenges that life will throw at you. These apostles were going to the other side as commanded by the Lord. They were in the ship appointed by the Lord. But as they moved, the Bible says a contrary wind arose against them. A contrary wind began to beat against them, threatening their lives, threatening their destinies, threatened even the word of God as he had spoken to them. And I want you to know that you enter into a courtship with a woman to marry, or a courtship with a man to marry, and it ended in a marriage, does not mean that there won't be contrary challenges. That you are in a fellowship directed to you by the Lord does not mean you won't face challenges in that fellowship. That you are under an apostleship does not mean there will be challenges. There will be wind that will blow. There will be storms that will rage. There will be waves that will beat against you. But if you stand upon the word of the Lord, if you will not surrender your grace and the calling of God in your life, you will overcome.
Amen.
Somebody say, I will overcome. Amen. And I will get to the other side. Say it one more time. Say, I will overcome and I will get to the other side. Say it this way. Say, I am unstoppable in my journey to the other side. I will get there. I will get there. It is colorful, shining bright. I will get there. It is colorful, shining bright. I will get there. My future is bright. I will get there. My future is bright. I must get there. That is the conviction that every man of faith must have. That no matter the storm that rages, no matter the wind that bloweth, the word of God stands forever. And by his word I will prevail. By his word I will overcome. Glory to the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
And finally, number five. As they were going to the other side, the supernatural backed them up. The supernatural overtook them. Now let me explain. There were four natural experiences that was happening to them as they were going. Number one, night fell. It was natural. It is a natural order of life that day and night will not cease. That summer and winter will not cease. So as they were journeying, the night came. Night is a season of darkness when you can't see clearly anymore. And darkness brings its own fear in the natural. So what does the night represent here? It represents natural fear, natural anxieties, natural, you know, uncertainties, thank you. Natural uncertainties. And so as you are going on your journey to the other side, there will be things that will affright you. There will be things you are not certain about. Hey, God said to Abraham, Abraham, arise, leave your country and your kindred.
Go to a land that I will show you. Then the Bible says Abraham stepped out into uncertainty. He left certain and he stepped out into uncertainties. But because he was going according to the word of the Lord, there was no fear. So though you are going according to the word of the Lord, there will be natural uncertainties, natural fears, natural doubts, natural challenges. Don't let them invalidate the word of God that he has spoken to you. Number two, they were in the middle of the night. Number two, they were in the middle of the sea. In the middle of the sea. See, night didn't fall on them while they were by the shore. Night didn't fall on them when they were close to the other shore. Night waited until they got into the middle of the sea. The night fell. I don't know the middle of what sea you are. I don't know the middle of what challenges you are. I don't know the middle of what debt you are. I don't know the middle of what difficulties you are. Because to be in the middle of the sea means to be in the middle of difficulties. It means to be in the middle of challenges. Though these guys were fishermen, they were not swimmers. They were only fishermen, they were not swimmers. And among them, there were only four fishermen. There were eight others that were not fishermen. So even if the fishermen among them knows how to swim, how will the other eight escape? Are you in the middle of a crisis right now? Are you in the middle of a debt? Are you in the middle of a body, the middle of the challenges, and you don't know how to go forward? You don't know how to turn backward. Relax and rejoice. There is a balm in Gilead that is able to soothe the painful wounds.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Number three. Not only were they in the midst of the night, not only were they in the middle of the sea, they were in the middle of a contrary wind. To be in the middle of the sea is not a challenge. If the sea is calm, if the sea is friendly, but to be in the middle of the sea and then there is a raging wind. Hey, sometimes I told myself and my wife, we were going to California and the plane was in the middle of the sea, in the middle of the icy Atlantic Ocean, and there was a wind that started blowing, and the plane was doing and they told everybody, fasten your seat belt. And the pilot said they needed to fly higher so that they can evade part of the wind that was contrary. The way my wife held my hand, I know that faith has mixed with fear. Is it that me too, I was not afraid? I was afraid. But if she's afraid, me too, I'm afraid. We are doomed. So I told her, I said, no shaking, no shaking, no shaking. The plane is shaking, you know, but I kept saying, no shaking, no shaking, no shaking. In the name of Jesus, no shaking. And for like 5 minutes, the plane was vibrating. Was doing... When we landed, she said, no wonder someone told me that a state governor does not fly with his wife or with his children. If they are going somewhere, they fly different planes. So that if they crash, all of them will crash at the same time. I said, we are not human governor. We have inside us the governor over the nations. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
So they were in the midst of the sea. They were in the middle of the night. And they were in the middle of a contrary wind. What is that contrary wind blowing against you? What is that contrary wind blowing against your health? Against your finances? Against your career?
against your marriage, I command that wind to cease right now. I command a cessation to that wind right now. I command a cessation to that wind right now.
I said, peace be still to every contrary wind. The fourth experience in that place is that all the 12 of them in the ship were afraid. So they were in the middle of the sea. They were in the middle of the night. They were in the middle of contrary wind. And now they are in the middle of fear. All of them together afraid. It looks like a lost cause. But suddenly, there came Jesus walking on the sea. Ah! The same sea that they were afraid of. The same sea they thought was going to swallow them. Here comes their master walking over the same sea. Here comes their savior walking on top of their problem. Walking on top of what is scaring them. Walking on top of what is affrighting them. If my master can walk on what is making me afraid, why then should I be afraid? Ah, that songwriter says, Father, you are king over the storm, and I will be still and know you are God. I will be still and know you are God. Lord, I will be still and know you are God. I will be still and know you are God. My friend, our God is the king over every storm. And if you are going according to his word, you are going with the sheep he has appointed. No matter the storm that comes against you, no matter the wind that rises against you, no matter the waves that blows over you, you are going to prevail.
Amen.
I say you are going to prevail.
Amen.
I say you are going to prevail.
Amen.
What your king has conquered, how can he then conquer you? It's impossible. It's impossible. Jesus came to them walking on the sea. And the Bible says they were afraid. They cried out thinking it was a ghost. Why? Because they have never seen such before. They were not afraid and cried out because they have never seen any man walking on the sea before. Even Mami Water cannot walk on top of the water. Peter would have known, because he would have seen Mami Water before walking on top of the water as a fisherman. But he has never seen before. I never seen this kind of God before.
Wonder, wonder,
wonder, wonder.
I never seen this kind of God before.
Wonder, 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 wonder.
I wonder, 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 wonder.
Wonder, 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 wonder.
He walk on the sea, he walk on the water.
Wonder, 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 wonder.
I never seen this kind of God before.
Wonder, wonder.
Crossing into the month of July, in this second half of the year, as the Lord liveth and as his spirit lives, what you have never seen before, the kind of wonder, the kind of breakthrough, the kind of supernatural lifting, God will do it in your life. God will do it in your family. God will do it in this church. God will do it in Nigeria. In the name of Jesus Christ. This is it. And I see God walking over this coronavirus right now. All over the world, Jesus is walking over the coronavirus. The storm of this virus is being stilled right now. In the name of Jesus Christ. And as they were afraid and crying out, Jesus spoke 10 words to them. 10 words he spoke to them. 10 words. 10 words. 10 words Jesus spoke to them. And that was enough. It was enough for Peter amongst them. What were those 10 words? Be of good cheer. It is I. Fear not. 10 words. It is I. Fear not. And those 10 words were enough for Peter. And Peter replied back with 10 words. He replied back with 10 words. If it be you, bid me come on the water. If it be you, bid me come on the water. Wow. If you are the one walking on the water, make me also to walk on it. Glory to God forever. Bid me to come. To come to what? To also walk over what is scaring me. Hear me, friends. The best way to overcome your fears is to confront it. Any fear you don't confront, you can never conquer. So for Peter to conquer this fear that was in his heart, you remember there were two fears. One, the fear of the uncertainty of the wave of the sea. Two, the fear of this person walking on the water coming to them that they thought was a ghost. So Peter said, number one, if it is you, I shouldn't be afraid. Because Jesus said, it is I, be not afraid. So Peter confronted that first fear. If it is you, I won't be afraid. Bid me come. The second fear, he now specified, bid me come on the water. The same water you are walking on, bid me to also come on it. Just a few minutes ago, Peter and the 10 and the 11 were afraid of this water. Peter said, I want to walk on that same water. The same thing that is making me afraid. This impossibility that I have seen you make possible, let me also walk in the reality. What audacity! What boldness! What desire! You want to conquer your fear? Do what you have been afraid of. You want to conquer your fear? Step out of the crowd of doubters and the fearful. Peter was in the midst of the sea, in the midst of doubters and fearful. He was in the middle of the night. He was not seeing clearly, yet he stepped out of the boat to do the impossible. As I close, what does it mean to walk on the sea? What does it mean to walk on the water? Don't forget my topic is, it is time to walk on the water. So what does it mean to walk on the water? Number one, it means we can do the works of Jesus Christ. That's what it means to walk on the water. Jesus said, the works that I do, shall you do also. And greater works than this shall you do. Peter started walking in that reality before Jesus pronounced it. If it be you, bid me to walk on the same water. Hallelujah.
Amen.
That's what it means to walk on the water. It means to do the works of Jesus Christ. What is the works of Jesus? To believe in? To believe in the God who sent him. To believe in his word. Number two, what does it mean to walk on water? It means we can walk. The first walk is W-O-R-K. The second one is walk. We can walk as Jesus walked. We can walk where Jesus walked. Jesus walked where angels fear to tread. You also can walk where angels and men are afraid of treading. The Bible says he has left us an example that we should walk in his steps. Friends, you can walk as Jesus walked. Number three, what does it mean to walk on water? It means the supernatural is available for us. It means the supernatural is available for you. It means that you don't need to walk in the natural alone. You can be walking in the natural and be operating in the supernatural. Hallelujah. And listen, if there is one way in which I know personally that I am walking, is in the supernatural divine supply of my needs. This is the 14th year that I have not earned a single salary. Not on any paid employment. No gratuity from anywhere. No pension from anywhere. Solid years, and I have not begged one day, and I have not lacked one day. Supernatural supply. And listen, if you don't believe it, you can't become it. I believe in supernatural supply, and day by day I see God bringing it to pass, supplying my needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Yesterday I was to make a bill of about 14,000 naira. I just told you I prayed with somebody 2 days ago. Yesterday they brought the healing report and they sent me 20,000 naira. How much did I need? 14,000. How much did I get? 20,000 naira. How much extra do I have? 6,000 naira. Hallelujah. 14 years. I didn't beg to pay my children's school fee. I don't beg. I don't look to anybody except God to meet my needs more than ever before. I want you to believe today. That is what it means to walk on water. It means to walk in the supernatural. Now, when we are talking about walking on water, what are the particles or components of water? Hydrogen and oxygen. What are those two? Air. Air. So when I say walk on water, we're meaning walk in the air. Walk in the air. It was as I'm preparing this study that it suddenly dawned on me that this is the oppression of the revelation that Maria would enter, broke into, that will make her to be preaching and standing on the altar and see somebody miles away that is sick as we walk in the air and lay hands on the person and heal the person and walk back on the air to the altar. What he was doing was walking on water. She was simply walking on the air. Hallelujah. And if you don't know, Job chapter 9 verse 8. Job chapter 9 and verse 8. Hey, glory to God forever. Job chapter 9 and verse number 8. What did he say? It says, he made, he alone spreads out the heavens and he treads on the waves of the sea. He treads on the waves of the sea. No matter how high the sea is raging, no matter how mighty the waves of the sea is, he alone treads on the waves of the sea. And listen to me. To walk on water means to step out of the crowd and be distinguished. It means to operate in what is exclusive to God. And you're walking in it. I want you to understand. The supernatural does not belong to man. It belongs to spirits. It belongs to the, that's why they call it supernatural. To walk on the water means you are stepping out of the crowd and you are being distinguished in what you do, in how you do it. Ha! You can walk on the water as a teacher. You do what other teachers are not doing. You stand out. You can walk on the water as a student. You study and excel above all others, maximizing the grace of God, maximizing the wisdom of God. That's what it means to walk on the water. And Peter did that. What is exclusive to God, Jesus shared it with Peter. Up to that point, nobody had walked on water. But Peter believed, and Jesus said, come. Because if you believe, you will become. Who has believed our report? To whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? He who believes will see it happen. Peter walked in what was exclusive to Jesus. Jesus extended it to Peter. He shared it with Peter. Finally, to walk on the water means to be helped by the power of God. And what is the power of God? Is the word of God. Hebrews 1:3. The Bible says he upholds all things by the word of his power. By the word of his power. So to walk on water means to walk with the word. To walk with the word. Each time you are walking with the word, you are walking on water. You are walking in the supernatural. God says go, and you are going. You are walking on water, my friend. God says give, and you are giving. You are walking on water. God says pray, and you are praying. You are walking on water. Because you are walking by the power of the word. Listen, what do you think helped Peter under the water that didn't make him sink? The word of God was what sustained him under the water. To walk on the water means to seize the moment, to take the opportunity that time and chance made available to you. That's what it means to walk on the water. It's to take opportunity of time and seasons. It's to maximize the moment. Even in the midst of this coronavirus crisis, you can maximize the moment. You can believe the Lord to give you a word of something to do that will turn your life around. To walk on the water means to leave a legacy of faith. Let me read Psalm 77 verse 19. Psalm 77 verse 19 as I close. Psalm 77 and verse 19. This is what it means to walk on water. He said your way was in the sea. Your path in the great waters. And your footsteps were not known. Who can actually count the footsteps that Peter walked that day? You can't see it. But we are reading it. It's a legacy of faith. Because faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. To walk on water means to leave a legacy, a trail of a walk of faith. A trail of the walk of life that you walk with God by faith. That's what it means to walk on water. How do you then walk on water? Four things. Number one, desire it. Desire all these things I've said. There were 12 in the boat, but only Peter desired to walk on water. If the 12 of them have said it, Lord, if it be you, bid us to come. All of them will walk on water. But it's recorded against Peter only, because he was the only one who desired. Number two, recognize his voice. See, all of them didn't recognize his person. They thought it was a ghost. But Peter recognized his voice. He said, Lord, it is you. So if it is you, bid me come. You remember Mary went to the sepulchre of Jesus on the resurrection morning. When Jesus appeared to her, she didn't recognize his person. She thought he was a gardener. She said, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have carried him, and I will not carry him back. And then Jesus answered and said, Mary. That was all Jesus needed to say. Mary turned back and said, Rabboni. Rabboni. Meaning master, teacher. She didn't recognize his person, but she recognized his voice. If you want to walk on water, there is a necessity laid upon you to recognize his voice. Because in the midst of the sea, his voice will sustain you. In the midst of the night, his voice will sustain you. In the midst of doubters, his voice will sustain you. And there are many voices in the world, but there is none that is without significance. But when you recognize the most significant voice, it makes you significant amongst men. Number three, act on his word. Don't just recognize his voice, act on it. Act on it, act on it, act on it. Act on the voice that comes to you. Act on it. Take steps, make moves. Take steps, make moves according to his voice. The moment he said, come, Peter didn't wait for a second time. As soon as he said, come, boom, Peter jumped out. Hallelujah. As soon as he said, come, Peter jumped out. Don't wait, don't second guess God's voice. Finally, number four. You want to walk on water? Eliminate all fear. Eliminate every fear. Because you see, as soon as Peter stepped out of the booth, we have all thought that Peter took his eyes off Jesus. That's why he started sinking. As I was preparing for this, I saw it. It was not because he took his eyes off Jesus. It was not his eyes on Jesus that made him walk on water. It was his heart on the word that made him walk on water. But something replaced the word in his heart. Fear replaced the word in his heart. Because as soon as he looked again and saw the water by stars, the Bible says he feared and started singing. And then Jesus now said to him, why did you doubt? Why did you fear? It's not why did you take your eyes off me. It's why did you fear? Why did you allow fear to replace my word in your heart? And number five, Peter cried out, Master, save me! And Jesus stretched out his hands and caught him. Learn to pray. Learn to cry out. Learn to desire God's help, even when you are acting on his word and the consciousness of his presence will save you. How many of you are ready to walk on water here? I am ready. I'm ready to do the supernatural. I'm ready to operate in signs and wonders. I'm ready to live according to his word and to live a trail of faith. Rise up on your feet and let us pray.